Hello, this is CA Swati Sharma. This video is going to be helpful for all the students who are aiming to score high in their CS exams. Today, we are going to discuss the EBCL mock exam question paper given by Excel Academy. We are going to analyze what are the points and contents that need to be included in your answer to score better. The purpose of discussing the question paper is to help the students understand that in addition to having the in-depth knowledge about the entire subject, it is equally important that the students must be able to analyze how to use that knowledge in presenting their answers. In this video, we are going to discuss how a combination of quality content and quality presentation can help students score better in their exams. If you have any questions, you can leave them in the comments section below. We will reply to them. Also, for any exam-related queries or preparation, you can subscribe to our Excel Academy channel. Let's begin the paper analysis.
Today we will be analyzing the EBCL mock exam paper of December 21, right? So let's begin the paper analysis. First question is for 5 marks, right? Let's see what is the question. What are the functions of the Reserve Bank of India? So how are you going to write this answer? So in the introduction, we'll give a brief background about what is the Reserve Bank, right? That it is the central bank, it is the banker's bank. Briefly, we will state what is the objective with which we have established the RBI in India, right? Then we will move ahead to quoting the functions of RBI. Mention all the functions and you can give a brief description of each of the points of each of the functions. Since it is a 5-mark question, you can give a one-liner explanation to each of the function that has been entrusted on the RBI. So while you're writing the answers, the first and foremost thing is to understand that you should clearly give headings to your answers and also subheadings. If possible, you can write your headings and subheadings with different pen, right? If you're writing your content with a blue pen, you can write your headings and subheadings using a black pen, right? So while quoting these headings and subheadings, it will clearly give the evaluator an idea about what is the content that you have touched upon in your answer. So this clear identification, if you're giving subheadings separately, it will help him clearly see what has been written and addressed in the answer. Right? So we'll give a brief introduction about what is RBI. Then we will go on to write what are the actual functions of RBI with one-liner explanation, and therefore conclude the answer that it plays an active role in balancing the relationship between the banks and the customer, right, in overall enforcement of the payment and settlement systems in India. So whatever conclusion you want, you can write the conclusion. So it is foremost important that you have an introduction to your answer, you have the actual content that has been asked in the question, and thereafter conclusion to your answer. So this format should be followed by you while you're answering all the questions, specifically when it is a 5-mark, 8-mark, 7-marks answer. Right? So for 4-marks or 3-marks answer, if you answer to the point, it is sufficient. But when you're answering the big questions or the lengthy question, it is very important that you have an introduction, content, and then conclusion to your answer. Now, moving to second question, this is also for 5 marks. State the prime functions of the Development Commissioner as incorporated under the Special Economic Zone Act of 2005. Similarly, we will in the introduction say who is the Development Commissioner, right? Then we will go on to state what are the functions of the Development Commissioner as laid down under the provisions of the Act. So you should clearly mention which section lays down the functions under which Act. Okay, so provisions, when you mention the provisions, you should mention the name of the Act or the name of the regulations or name of the rules, whichever is applicable, and then the number. So which section, which rule or which regulation. Then state the functions of the Development Commissioner. We have studied all these provisions. So mention those points and then go on to conclude your answer by saying that it is the responsibility of the commissioner to take steps to discharge functions that has been entrusted upon him, that is for speedy development of the special economic zone and promotion of exports from these special economic zones. So this is the overall objective of establishing a development commissioner in the special economic zone. Moving to the third question, that is question 1C, this is also for 5 marks. Name any 5 permissible current account transactions made by an individual under the liberalized remittance scheme. So clearly state why has there been establishment of this scheme, right? Why does the RBI issue these schemes? Then, because we have to talk about what are the permissible current account transactions, you can give a brief description of what is a current account transaction. Once we know what is a current account transaction in a brief introduction, then we can go on to say what all is permissible under the current account transactions. Okay, so you can give, there are a lot of permissible transactions, but since in the question they have said list any five, okay, you can select any five, whichever you remember, you can write those 5 points, okay. Whether it is private visits, gift and donation, global going on board, employment to a foreign country or immigration, right? Business trip, whichever 5 points you want, you can write. And thereafter, conclude your answer by stating what is the limit, okay, what is allowed. And over and above, if you cross this limit, if you are exceeding this limit, then you will have to take prior permission. Even though it is a permissible transaction, prior permission will be required if it is in excess of the limit that has been set up. So this is how you are going to structure your answers. Next. 5 marks. Question 1D. How a person resident in India can hold, own or transfer or invest in any immovable property which is situated outside India? Comment on this statement. So we will state under which regulations it is governed. It is governed under the FEMA Act 1999 under Section 6A. Okay, we will give the details about what is the enactment that governs that particular statement and a brief introduction about that statement. Then we will go into the main content of the answer, that is the modes in which we can actually invest in property that is situated outside India, that is by a resident in India. So what are all the points, the contents? We are not going into the depth of what is the provision of law. We are just seeing what are the points that are required to be covered under these particular questions. Right? We will write the modes of acquiring the property which is laid down under the FEMA Act, and then we will give a conclusion that if whenever a person is resident in India, he can deal with the immovable property, but it should be always as per the provisions as laid down under the FEMA Act. Moving to question 2 or 2A, it is an alternative question, but we will cover all. So 2A, this is for 4 marks, right? Whether conversion of external commercial borrowings into equity is permissible or not. So it is a comment statement. So first we should clearly establish whether it can be converted or it cannot be converted. That is the primary question that is being asked. Once we will say yes or no, and then we will say what is the law on the basis of which we are saying that yes, it can be permitted or no, it cannot be permitted, right? So you should justify your answer, whether it is a yes or a no, whatever you think, whatever is your opinion, you should justify that by quoting the relevant provisions of law, right? And first and foremost thing, because we are talking about the external commercial borrowings, we can give a brief definition of what is a external commercial borrowing. So in the introduction, okay, we'll start a statement by the answer whether it can be converted or not. Yes, it can be converted. We will say what is the meaning of ECB, right? Then the transactions are governed, okay, ECB transactions are governed under the FEMA Act. So what are the provisions for that? And then main topic, main content, whether it can be converted. Now, because we have answered that yes, it can be converted, what are the provisions of law? What are the conditions that are established? That those conditions should be laid down under your main content. This is the main content which will fetch you marks. Then conclusion, on satisfying the above mentioned criteria and conditions, ECBs can definitely be converted into equity shares. So ultimately you should give a conclusion to your answer, right? Whether it can be done or it cannot be done on the basis of the provisions that you have quoted above, on that basis give a justification that because of the provisions as stated above, it is possible to convert the ECBs into equity. But it is very important that you state clearly that only if the conditions are satisfied, only then we can convert it into equity. Right? Next. This is also a 4-mark question. That is 2B. Discuss various modes of payment allowed for receiving a foreign direct investment to an Indian company. So this is entirely based on the FDI. So we will brief in the introduction, we will give a brief about what is an FDI, what are the various routes. This is the main content of your answer. What are the modes of payment? Right, we have studied this. You can mention the modes of payment, and then once the modes are mentioned, then you will conclude that if an FPI is received, it should always be in the mode that is as permitted under the regulations and as per the act that is laid down by the regulations laid down by the RBI. Next, point out the prohibited transactions under the liberalized remittance scheme. So similarly, we will take an introduction. We will say that why are there certain transactions that have been prohibited under the FEMA Act, give an introduction of those provisions, and then we will quote what are a list of all the transactions that have been exclusively prohibited. So we are there clearly indicated, indicative list has been given that these transactions can never be allowed. So these are the prohibited transactions, and then conclusion, NLRS has clearly laid down the transactions which are prohibited and definitely cannot be undertaken by any person in India. Next, 2B, what do you mean by a non-banking financial company? Enumerate the powers of the RBI vested by the RBI Act for regulating and supervising the non-banking financial companies. So this question is divided into two parts. First is, you should tell them what is an NBFC. Second, you should tell them what are the powers of the RBI when it is actually regulating these non-banking financial companies. So we will start an answer also like that by giving a heading, that is the NBFC. In that we will quote, we will state what is NBFC. Right? Give a definition or give a meaning in your own terms. If you remember the definition, you can write the definition or you can also give it in your own language. Then we will go on to the second part of the question, that is what is the powers of the RBI, right? The powers of the RBI, as per the RBI Act, we will say that these powers are entrusted to the RBI by the RBI Act. And what are the powers? State the powers as given under the provisions of the Act. Next, moving to the fifth question, how is the Monetary Policy Committee constituted under the RBI Act and what are its functions? So similarly, here also they are asking you two questions. One is about the constitution of that particular Monetary Policy Committee, and second one is what are the functions of that particular committee. Right? So first, we will tell them what is a Monetary Policy Committee, right? Who has the power to establish that committee and what is the purpose with which this committee is established. Thereafter, we will talk about the first question, that is what is the constitution of the committee, how is it constituted, who are the members that constitute this particular committee. Thereafter, second question we will answer, that is what is the role and functions of the Monetary Policy Committee, right? So this is how you are going to structure or present your answer. Please make sure that you give sufficient headings and subheadings that will only help the evaluator know whether you have covered all the points or not. Right? If you don't give any headings, you just start writing the answer without segregating your answer into constitution and role, they might miss out on some points and full marks might not be awarded. So if you clearly give a structure to your answer, give headings, give subheadings, and clearly distinguish between two different points to two different parts of your answer, it will help you score better. Right? Then this is the functions or this is the role of the committee. Moving to the alternative question, that is 2A. So this is also for 4 marks. Right? So NBFCs are akin to that of a bank, but they are different from banks in certain cases. Explain. So we have to quote the difference between the banks and the NBFCs. Though they provide certain similar functions, they still differ in certain cases. What is that difference that is required to be stated? So we'll give a brief meaning of what is an NBFC, right? And then we will quote what is the difference between bank and NBFC. There are 3 points of difference. You can mention all the 3 points of difference and then it will help you score full 4 out of 4. But please give a brief introduction of what is an NBFC, and you can also give the definition of a bank, right? Meaning of a bank, and then you can quote the difference between the bank and the NBFC. Next, explain the brief scope and procedure for compounding of contravention under the FEMA Act. So when you read this question, so you should clearly help the examiner understand that you know the meaning of the words compounding of contravention. What is the meaning or what is the concept of compounding of contravention? So that is why we'll start an answer about telling them what is compounding of contravention. We will give a brief meaning of what is compounding, that it is a voluntary process of admitting the contravention or pleading guilty and seeking your redressal. Then what is contravention? Whenever you breach the provisions of the FEMA Act, there is a contravention of the provision. And for this, the RBI has been empowered to compound and contravention any provisions, right? Any offence. Thereafter, we'll go to the main content. They have asked you two things. The first thing is scope of compounding, and second one is the procedure for compounding the offence under the FEMA Act. So we will give them. This is the actual content, actual provision of law that you are required to quote. Give the provisions of law. State the procedure point wise, right? And then you will conclude your answer. So first, you tell them what is contravention, what is compounding, what does compounding of contravention means, who has the power to compound the contravention, what is the scope, and what is the procedure of contravention under the FEMA Act. So this is how you are going to lay down or design your answer. Moving to the third question, 2A, state the provisions relating to penalties and punishment provided under the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. So it is a 4-mark question, right? So we know what are the penalties and punishments. So why will you be imposed with penalty or punishment under the FEMA Act? So for that, we should see the objective. So if you contravene the objectives of the provisions which are laid down under the FCRA Act, then you will be eligible or liable to penalty or any kind of punishment under the provisions. So briefly, we will tell what is the objective of, you know, actually enacting this particular act. And then we will say whoever contravenes the provisions of this particular enactment will be penalized and punished according to the contravention. Whatever provision has been contravened, for that whatever penalty or whatever punishment is given, that will be imposed on the wrongdoer. Then we will go to the main content by stating the side heading, that is penalties and punishments under the Act. You can mention the sections 33, 34, 35, right, and then 39. 41, and you can state what are all the penalties and punishments, and then that is how you are going to conclude the answer. Next, who can establish a special economic zone? Discuss. So they are talking about a special economic zone. So we will tell them what is a special economic zone, what is the meaning of a special economic zone, what is the purpose for which the special economic zones are created. Thereafter, we will talk about the establishment. Who has the power? So it is the central government or the state government or any other person jointly or severally may establish a special economic zone, right? What is the purpose for its establishment? We will state that. And then we will conclude that these zones are established for ensuring growth of the area, that is the SEZ, by boosting manufacturing, augmenting the exports and generating employment. So the more the manufacturing in a particular unit, the more is the development of that particular area or zone. So that is the entire purpose of establishing a special economic zone. So this is how we are going to structure our answer. Tell them what is a special economic zone. Lay down the content about the establishment, who is allowed to establish, what is the objective of establishing, and then give a conclusion to your answer as to why establishment of these SEZs are important. Moving to the last question of this sub-question of this question, that is, enumerate the sectors or activities where the FDI is completely prohibited under the FDI policy of India. So we'll briefly tell them what is the FDI policy, that certain transactions are allowed, but there are also certain sectors that are prohibited clearly. Okay, clearly the government lays down that in these sectors we cannot receive any FDI in India. Right? So what are those sectors? A list of sectors is given. You can mention that list, and that is sufficient. So this is a 4-mark question. Right? So you can just mention all the sectors. Moving to part 2, that is entirely based on the Competition Act. Right? So what is the question? Whether the jurisdiction of the Competition Commission of India extends to acts or agreements taking place outside India which affects the competition in India, explain the concept. So this is a 3-mark question. So you don't have to specifically give an introduction or a conclusion. You can just give headings, subheadings on the basis of the question that they have asked. So here, by reading the question, we know that the question is related to the extraterritorial jurisdiction. So give a subheading, give a main heading to your answer, that is extraterritorial jurisdiction of the CCI, that is the Competition Commission of India. So one more thing that I would like to quote here is whenever you're using the abbreviations in your answer, for the first time when you're using it, give a complete description of that particular abbreviation. Thereafter, start using CCI. So, first time when you're mentioning CCI, along with that, give an explanation what does CCI stand for. Thereafter, in answer, whenever you're using that particular word, simply mentioning CCI will be sufficient. This will save your time in the examination. Every time you don't have to write a lengthy word, Competition Commission of India, you can definitely use the abbreviation. But first time when you're using it in your answer, please give an expansion of what that word means. Right? So here we are talking about the extraterritorial jurisdiction of the Competition Commission of India. We will lay down what is the provision. So we know Section 32 of the Competition Act of 2002 deals with the extraterritorial jurisdiction. So mention that provision and then state whether the Competition Commission has the power or not. Yes, it has. When it has it is impacting the competition in India, then definitely the Competition Commission has an extraterritorial jurisdiction. So what are all the provisions, right? What are the provisions that are laid down under 32? Give that, explain that in your answer. That is sufficient. Since it is only a 3 marks question, you can just clearly communicate to them by the way of headings that this concept is entirely based on extraterritorial jurisdiction. We have understood that this question is related to extraterritorial jurisdiction, and that is why the provision of Section 32 will be applicable. Give what is mentioned in Section 32, and that is sufficient for you to score full 3 marks. Next, what are the objectives of the Competition Act of 2002? So what are the objectives? We know it is to promote and sustain competition in the market. It is to protect the interest of the consumers or ensure free freedom of trade that is carried on and other participants, right? And for matters connected therewith, and also for the establishment of the Competition Commission of India to prevent practices having adverse effect on competition. So these are the main objectives of the Competition Act as per the preamble. Preamble of the Competition Act 2002 lays down the objectives. So you can also quote the preamble. Okay, that the preamble of the Act states as follows. That is how we are going towards the objective. That is the establishment of or the enactment of this particular Act is for this purpose. That is got from the preamble of the Act. What do you mean by a cartel? Explain with reference to the Competition Act. So this question is a 3 marks question. So you just have to give the divided answers into 2 parts. First is give a brief explanation of what is a cartel, and in reference to cartel, whatever provisions are laid down under the Competition Act, mention those provisions. So cartel under the Competition Act, give the meaning. Okay, Section 2 gives the definition. What is a cartel? Thereafter, the other provisions. Okay. So this is sufficient for you to fetch full 3 out of 3. Explain the terms relevant product market, relevant geographical market with reference to the Competition Act. We know that the relevant product market and the relevant geographical market, the words are used in the definition of relevant market. So first you will tell them what is a relevant market. In that there are 2 categories, A and B. Thereafter we will define what is a relevant geographical market and what is a relevant product market. So it is important that in this particular answer you give them what is a relevant market, because they should know from where the concept of geographical market or product market is coming into existence. So that is on the basis of the definition of relevant market that they have segregated it into geographical market and product market. So they have just asked you to explain the terms. So explain all these 3 terms. It is sufficient. You can also give them certain examples, practical examples for knowledge that you have. You can quote it in your answers. Next, what agreements are anti-competitive agreements as per the Competition Act? So we know clear provisions have been laid down under the Act. You can mention those provisions, right? A list is given as to what is an anti-competitive agreement. That list can be provided. Next, explain the procedure for investigation of a combination under the Competition Act of 2002. So this is a 5 mark question. So we'll have to tell them first what is a combination. Thereafter, in the main content, so introduction will be about combination. What is combination? Why are there threshold limits? And if it exceeds the threshold limit, then the CCI has the power to investigate into those combinations. So we'll give that in the introduction about what is a combination, that you know, if there is a beyond the threshold limit, then the CCI will have the power to investigate, and that power of investigation is vested on the CCI. All these provisions can be quoted in your own terms, in your own language. Thereafter, go to the main content of your answer, that is the procedure for investigation of combination. So it is laid down under section 29 of the Competition Act. Mention the section, mention the provision, and then step-wise, stage-wise, point-wise, lay down the procedure. One after other, what happens? How is the application filed, or how does the CCI Sumoto take a combination investigation into its hand? How does it do? What is the timeline, time period within which it has to complete the investigation? All those provisions can be mentioned in the procedure. Moving to the next question, this is also for 5 marks. What factors have to be taken into consideration by the CCI for the purpose of determining whether an enterprise is enjoying a dominant position or not? Explain. So we have to tell them what are the factors that are taken into consideration by the CCI while determining whether an entity is enjoying a dominant position or not. So we should first and foremost tell them what is a dominant position, right? So we should give a meaning or explanation of what is dominant position, and we should also clearly state that the Competition Act prohibits any enterprise from abusing its dominant position. So here it is clear to us that if an entity holds a dominant position, there is no problem in it. Only when it starts abusing its dominant position, that is where the CCI will come into picture and it will analyze the problem. So that is what we will give in the introduction, and then we will mention the factors that is laid down under section 4 as to determining whether there is any abuse or whether the entity enjoys a dominant position. Only if you are able to establish that a particular entity is enjoying the dominant position, then we can say whether there is abuse or there is no abuse of dominant position. So first and foremost, for the CCI, it is important to establish and identify whether a particular entity actually holds a position of dominance in the market or not. So for that, what are the factors that are to be taken into consideration? Those factors will be mentioned, and thereafter you will give a conclusion. This is a 5 marks answer, so very important to give a valid conclusion to your answer. So we should clearly say that the Competition Act does not prohibit dominance, but it only prohibits the abuse of the dominant position, right? And while identifying whether an entity has a dominant position or not, the CCI will take into consideration the above mentioned factors that we have already quoted in our answer, right? So the main thing, apart from the content, right, we know we should concentrate on content and presentation. Both these points are extremely important for scoring well in your exam. So you should have quality content as well as presentation of your answer. When I say presentation of answer, it also includes to know actually what should be included and what should be excluded. You know entire Competition Act of 2002, but you should be able to identify from that which provision is relevant in this particular answer, what should I keep in this answer and what I should not include in my answer, right? All that is the way it comes under the presentation skills of what you should be able to identify, what should be included in your answer and what should be left outside the answer. You might know everything, but it is not necessary that all the knowledge should be used in one particular answer. Right? Based on the question, be able to analyze what should be included and what should be excluded. Moving on to the last part, that is part 3, question 5A. Question 5A is also for 4 marks. Right? So they've given a brief facts of a particular case. This is a practical oriented question. A complainant has booked a ticket from Delhi to New York via a plane. The airport authorities in New Delhi did not find any fault in his visa or any other documents. However, at Amsterdam, the airport authorities instituted a proceedings for verification, because of which the appellant has missed his flight to New York. After reaching New York, the airline authorities have tendered an apology to the appellant for inconvenience caused and also has paid a sum of ₹2,500 as a gesture of the goodwill. The appellant made a complaint to the National Commission under the Consumer Protection Act. Whether the complainant will succeed, give reasons for this particular situation on the base of decided case laws. So when they have asked you for a conclusion, whether he will succeed or not, so you have to clearly give them a judgment whether he will succeed or not succeed. So we will start our statement with our opinion whether he will succeed or not. So we will say that the complainant will not succeed. That is how we are going to start our answer. After this, our answer should contain a justification. Okay, on what basis we are saying that he will not succeed in his case if he files in the National Commission. So this entire concept is based on deficiency of service. So we will tell them what is deficiency, and because here the airline facilities have not fulfilled their service, whether they have given the service properly or whether there is any deficiency in the service that has been provided by those particular airline agencies. So they have told you to explain with the help of a relevant case law. So whenever a question states that explain with the help of a case law, separate marks will definitely be allotted for the case law. So you have to quote the case laws if you want full marks in that particular question. If you fail to mention the case laws, then definitely marks will be cut and you will not be awarded full marks. So this present case, we are quoting Ranveer Singh Bagga versus the KLM Royal Dutch Fin Times. We will state what is the judgment in that particular case, and that is the same thing that will also apply to our case. And on this judgment, we are stating that he is not going to succeed in his case. Next. X draws a check in favor of Y, a minor. Y endorses the same in favor of Z. The check is dishonored by the bank on the grounds of inadequate funds. What legal remedies are available to Z under the provisions of the Negotiable Instruments Act? So they're asking what are the remedies that are available under the Negotiable Instrument Act in case of dishonor of check. So you know that the concept is based on dishonor of check. Please put a heading and then state the provisions. What are the provisions? Section 26 of the NI Act is applicable. Mention what does the section say and talk about minor, because here we have a Y who is minor who has received the check, right? So lay down the provisions, what are applicable in respect of minor, what is the capacity, and then give your ultimate conclusion on the basis of the instant case and on the basis of the provisions that we have mentioned above. We will give them a conclusion that in given case Z can recover the amount of check from X who delivers the check in favor of Y, a minor, by resorting to the provisions of the NI. So we have given the conclusion that yes, Z can recover the amount from Mr. X. Next. X gives Y property worth 5,000 and adds a condition that Y should sell the property for ₹75,000 and not below that amount. Right? This condition will at once become invalid, for no one will buy the property which is worth 5,000 for 75,000. Similarly, X gives a property to Y worth 75,000 and states that if Y wants to sell the property, he can sell it to Z only for ₹2,000. Decide with the help of a case law whether it is an absolute restraint under the law relating to transfer of property. So here we are talking about restraint on transfer of property, whether it is valid, whether it is void, what are the provisions of the NI Act, and in this instant case, can these conditions which are imposed be valid or will be invalid? So we will talk about Section 10 of the Transfer of Property Act. What does it state? It says that any such condition which is laid down restraining absolute transfer will always be invalid. And we have to quote a case law, because in the question they clearly said that by quoting a case law, explain the provisions. So whatever happened in this, give a brief description about the facts and what was the judgment that was passed in that particular case. The same thing will be applicable to our particular case that we will state in the conclusion. We will state in the conclusion that in the present case, the conditions stipulated are in nature of absolute restraint and therefore it will be void. It will be invalid. It cannot be considered and those conditions will not be accepted. Moving to the next question, a minor has fraudulently overstated his age and purchased a motor car for executing a promissory note in favor of the owner of a motor car for its price. The car owner has compelled the minor to pay the amount of the promissory note. Whether the car owner will succeed, explain with the help of two provisions they are saying, Indian Contract Act as well as Specific Relief Act. So here we are mainly talking about agreement by a minor. So here minor has fraudulently, right, he has misrepresented his age. It is his fault. He has committed a fraud, right? So whether it is valid or whether it is invalid, we have to tell them with the help of two provisions. One is under the Indian Contract Act and another one is under the Specific Relief Act. So we will state then what are the provisions of the Indian Contract Act, what are the provisions of the Specific Relief Act, and then we will give them a conclusion whether in the present case the owner will succeed or not. So they are saying that in the present case the car owner will not succeed in getting the amount of promissory note, but he can get back his motor car. So on the basis of the facts of the case, on the basis of the provisions of law, they have mentioned. Next. A shopkeeper sold a packet of pre-packet chilies which does not bear any kind of declaration which is required to be made by the manufacturer on a pre-packaged commodity. Whether the shopkeeper has committed any act that is punishable under the Legal Metrological Act discussed. So we know that whenever there is any product that is pre-packed, they have to give a description on the product, right? What is the quantity, right? What are the ingredients that have been used, right? What is the price? Right, when it is manufactured, the date, right, the expiry date, all these are the things that are to be included in the description on the product if it is pre-packed commodity. So in this case, the shopkeeper has sold it without that declaration. So is it punishable under the Legal Metrological Act? That is what is being asked. So we will talk about the contravention. So we will mainly discuss about the contravention of the provisions. We will mention section 18 that says that no person shall sell, manufacture, sell, import, distribute, deliver any product, right, which does not have description. So that is the provision that we are quoting. We are quoting also section 38, and that is the actual penal provision. What is the punishment? So the first offense, what is the punishment? And for the second offense, what is the... So for first one, you will be punished with fine which may extend to 25,000 rupees, and thereafter if you are continuing the same offense again or you are doing it for the second time, then the penalty can extend up to 50,000 rupees, and thereafter, even after second offense, you are still continuing to do it as a continuing offense, then it may be beyond 50,000 rupees, but it may extend to 1 lakh rupees. In addition to that, you will also be imprisonment for a term which may extend to the period of 1 year, or you can give. Right. So this is the contravention provision that is laid down under the Legal Metrological Act for the not declaring the contents of the product or description is missing. So in this case, he will definitely be held liable for punishment under the provision of section 36. Moving to the last question of this particular question paper, that is question 6. This is for 3 marks each. They have asked you to distinguish between the following. So whenever there is a question on distinguish, try to put it in a tabular format, in a table format. Right? It is easy to understand, and it is easy also for you to write the differences. So what is the difference between first mortgage and charge? Right? There is a transfer of interest in the property made by the mortgagor as a security of the loan. Here, there is no transfer of interest in the property. Right? Though you are giving it as a security, there is no transfer of interest. Next, in mortgage, it can only be created by the act of parties, whereas a charge can be created also by the operation of law. In mortgage, the deed must be mandatorily registered and it should be attested by 2 witnesses, whereas a charge need not always be in writing, but if it is reduced into writing, it need not be attested or registered by the witnesses. In certain types of mortgage, that is by mortgage by conditional sale, the mortgager can foreclose the mortgage property, whereas the charge holder can never foreclose, though he can get the property sold as in a simple mortgage. They are saying that the transferee of the mortgage property from the mortgager can only acquire the remaining interest of the mortgager, and it is therefore only bound by the mortgage. A charge as a general rule cannot be enforced against the transferee for consideration without notice. So it is very important that notice is given. Next. In a mortgage, there can be security as well as personal liability involved, whereas in charge, it is only the security. You cannot be personally held liable in case of charge. Next, moving on to the second difference between the vested and contingent interest. So here also 3 points of difference. The owner's title is already perfect in case of vested interest. In case of contingent interest, the title is not yet perfect, it is imperfect. Only after the conditions are fulfilled, it will be transferred from the imperfect title to the perfect title. A vested interest takes effect from the date of transfer, whereas contingent interest will take effect only on the date or the contingency or the condition which is laid down after the fulfillment of that. From that date, it will take effect. So that is the difference between the vested interest and contingent interest. So in the first one, they're just given the meaning. What is the meaning of contingent interest and vested interest? Moving to the fourth point, the vested interest cannot be defeated by death of the transferee, whereas the contingent interest can fail if before the fulfillment of condition, either the transferor or the transferee dies. Vested interest is transferable as well as heritable, whereas contingent interest is not heritable and it cannot be transferred also. Contract for service and contract of service. Okay, we know employer-employee relationship. Here, client and contractor relationship. The employee works for the employee. Okay, in contract for service, you are carrying out your business by yourself for yourself and you will get a payment for that. Right? So ultimately, it is your business. Here, it is somebody else's business for whom you are working, for which you are getting a salary. Here, you are getting a professional fees for your business. And this is the definition, okay, of what is contract for service or contract of service. Next, difference between derailment and sale. Right, meaning of sale. What is meaning of sale? What is meaning of derailment? Whether what is transferred, both title and possession is transferred in case of sale. Whereas in case of derailment, only the possession is transferred. The title is not transferred. Return of goods, the buyer will never return back the goods to the person who has sold it to him. Whereas a bailee is under an obligation to return back the goods once the bailment is completed. Next, difference between sale and agreement to sell. So whether there is transfer of ownership or not, in sell, yes, sale, there is transfer of ownership. Whereas in agreement to sell, you are only agreeing to transfer the ownership on a future date. Currently on this, as on the date of agreement to sell, you are not transferring the ownership. Status, it is already executed. This is executory, means it has to happen in future. Right? Nature of contract, it is contract plus conveyance. Today you are entering into a contract, you are also transferring the property. Whereas it is only a contract, you are not transferring the property or you are not transferring the ownership. That will happen on a future date. So it is only an agreement. It is only a contract. There is no conveyance of property. Right? Liability in case of loss, if the goods are destroyed by accident, the loss will definitely fall on the buyer because the goods are already sold. Whereas if it is an agreement to sell, it will be remaining on the seller because it is not completely finally executed. It is executory in future. It has not been executed, so the liability will be on that of the seller. Remedies, here if the seller commits the breach of contract by refusing to deliver you the goods, then the buyer has not only personal remedy, but he will also have other legal remedies for recovery of the goods. But if seller commits a breach when you have of agreement to sell, then he has only a personal remedy against the seller, that is to claim damages. He does not have resort to any other kind of legal remedy. So the alternative question is 6A. This is also for a 3 marks. Right? State the penalty provisions for use of non-standard weights and measures under the Legal Metrological Act. So because it is a 3-mark question, we will directly go and state what is the penalty, which is the section which imposes the penalty, and what is the penalty. So what is the first offence penalty, what is the second and subsequent offence penalty, we will clearly mention. Moving to the second question. Describe the contracts which cannot be specifically enforced under specific relief act. So give a side heading, that is the contracts which cannot be specifically enforced. Lay down the provisions, that is section 14 of which act, of specific relief act, and tell them, give the list of contracts which cannot be enforced. So these are the provisions that we have already studied in our classes. We know the provisions, we just have to mention them here. Next, what are the essentials of a promissory note? Right, we know the essentials of promissory note. Mentioned that it should be in writing, right? All these provisions we have studied in detail in our classes. So an instrument must possess the following essentials to qualify as a promissory note. So what are all those essentials? Mention those essential ingredients. Since this is only a 3 marks question, detailed explanation of the definition of what is a promissory note, all that is not required. You can definitely include in your answer, but even if it is not there, but you mention all the points correctly, all the essentials correctly, you will get full 3 marks. Next, explain the functions of the Real Estate Regulatory Authority, that is the RERA, under the Act of 2016. So what are the functions under the Act? We will mention So there are a lot of functions. If you remember all very well and good, you can quote all of them. All else, because it is a 3 marks question, you can also quote 5 to 6 functions. That is sufficient. Especially you should quote all the primary functions for which they are established. Next, whether a minor may be admitted in the business of a partnership under the Partnership Act of 1932, and whether the minor will have any kind of right in the partnership firm. So they are talking about the concept of admission of a minor in as a partner in the partnership firm, that is clearly laid down under Section 11. You can also quote the case law, and that you give the provisions what is stated under Section 11, and thereafter we will talk about what are the rights of the minor as a partner in a partnership firm and conclude the answer. It is a 3 mark question, so detailed explanation of these rights are not required. If you mention what are the rights available to the minor, that is sufficient. So this brings us to the end of the question paper discussion. If you have any doubts, if you have any questions with respect to this, please leave your doubts in the comment section below. We will get back to you. We will reply to your queries. And for more such videos, you can subscribe to our Excel Academy channel. For any other support, examination related support, or any support with respect to the entire CS course, you can always contact Excel Academy. You can contact our WhatsApp number. You can also download the Excel Academy app from the Play Store. You can also register or have a free sign up on our website.